Hello everyone, welcome to the Geoecologist. I'm Dr. Krishnanand, and in this session, we are going to learn about the contributions of Indian scholars in the evolution of geographical thought. Right from the ancient, since Mesopotamia, till the rise of geography as an advanced study subject in the European nations in America, we have learnt it all. So now, let's reflect on ourselves as Indians, that what is the contribution of Indian scholars right from the ancient till today. We'll be highlighting most of the work that was contributed by Indian scholars to the evolution of geographical thought. So before we go ahead, please do like and subscribe to our channel, and don't forget to press the bell icon for further updates. So now, let's understand that Indian geography has a long history, and the long history can be studied from the sources like Vedicas, Ramayana, Mahabharata, and work of Buddhists, Jains, and various Puranas. Apart from that, the travel accounts of Chinese and Arab travelers to India provide valuable information about the places that they traveled. So, geographical history of India, if we want to study, we need to study all these travelogues apart from these major literary sources that we say. So, Chinese pilgrims like Huan Sang, Fei Yan, Sung Yun, and apart from that, when we study about Megasthenes, who wrote Indica. So, that was the one of the important sources in terms of the travelogue. So, these travelogues help us to understand what was the relationship of people with those places that they have mentioned in their travelogues. Apart from that, later on we find that in 16th, 17th and 18th century, when India was a British colony in that particular time, European travelers came and wrote their experiences. So these are the sources from which we gather the information about our geographical history. So that is where, if you want to understand the evolution of geographical thought in India, we need to look into these particular traditions. So as we observe that during the Greeks and Romans, there were literary and astronomical and mathematical traditions. Similarly, here as well, we have literary traditions which are composed of narratives and folklores. Apart from that, astronomical and mathematical traditions. So these are the two major traditions in India as well. So if we look at the literary tradition in India, Indian scriptures can be divided largely into two segments. One is called Shruti and the other is called Smriti. So the word Shruti itself means that which was heard. And the other segment is the Smriti, that is what is remembered right from the memories. So what we observe here is that knowledge or information for that matter passed from one person to the other or from one generation to the other, not through the written traditions originally, but right through the oral traditions. So this Shruti and Smriti, what we observe here is largely giving us idea about the oral traditions, and through that we are going to trace the evolution of geographical thought. So let's understand these traditions. Shruti comprises of these four major segments of the Vedas. So that is Rig Veda, Sam Veda, Yajurved and Atharva Veda. And apart from that, we have something which is called Vedanta, that is majorly into Upanishads. So we have Karmakanda, which basically means the ritual part. So it has Samhita and Brahmanas. And apart from this, we have Gyanakanda, in which we have knowledge accumulation. So that is through Aranyaka and Upanishads. Now when we observe at the other segment, which is through memories, we have Dharmashastra, Puranas, Itihasas, that we say history, historical tradition. And then we have Darshan, which we say philosophy. And then we have Upaved. So Ved and Upaved are two major classifications. So what we observe is that in the oral tradition even, the first was the Vedic period. So what we see here is the 1500 to 500 before Christ, or before Common Era what we say, largely in the late Bronze and Iron Age in India, what we observe is that Vedas were created. So coming from the oral traditions of hearing. So one person listened and stored the knowledge and then conveyed it to the other person. And then later, when we observe this particular period of Puranas, that is the later period, that is from 3rd to 10th century Common Era, that is after death, that is AD. So there we observe these traditions of Dharmashastra, Puranas, Itihas, Darshan and Upaved. So Shruti tradition is the earlier part and Smriti tradition is the later part in terms of Indian scriptures, especially when we talk about the
ancient ones. So further, if we observe, it has so many things there. So Dharmashastra was about the law segment. So we have Manusmriti, Yajnavalkaya Smriti, then Parashara Smriti, Narada Smriti. So many memories. So when we say memories and Smriti, what are these memories about? These are the same memories about what existed before this particular time period. It means these are the memories of the Shrutis only. So what happened during Shrutis was memorized and again recreated through the memory. That's why they are called Smritis. So when we observe Dharmashastra, Purana, Itihas, Darshan and Upaveda, and in there further we have Vedangas and Agamas, these are all part of the memories of the past. So they have been created by memorizing right from one person, one family, through genealogy, through Gurukula system. So that is where knowledge was preserved and it was transferred from one generation to the other. So these are the literary sources that we have in the forms of these Vedas and Upanishads and Puranas and Itihasas in forms of Ramayana and Mahabharata, which was later on during British time, during colonial rule, translated. So what we observe here is that translations happened. So right from the ancient that got translations into first Arabic, and then also later on from Arabic it came to Latin as well, again went to Europe. So some segments are there in Latin if you observe, which were later on translated into English. So when it got translated into English, it became a worldwide phenomena because of the colonialism. So what happens? One major thing that we should always remember, that translations are not foolproof and they also have loss of information and knowledge as well. So what happened? Many things were lost in translation, and apart from that, many things were burned during the various kinds of wars for the power conquest. So many libraries that existed were burned. So the entire education system was completely changed from the ancient in the Middle Ages and during the colonial times. So apart from that, what we observe here is that many transformations happened. So apart from translations, what happened? Transformations in the education system. So when education system from ancient came to the Middle Ages during the Arab reign, so what happened? There was a change in the education system, the Islamic system came, and then again the colonial system or the English education dominated. So what we observe here in modern Indian texts of geography or modern Indian texts as well, that there are certain imprints of ancient as well, medieval in terms of the Islamic scholars' contribution as well, and also the British contribution as well. So what we observe in terms of Indian scriptures and their standardization, their translations, the imprints of these changes, this transformation will be visible. So let's understand further more. So when we talk about geographical description of the earth or the mapping of the earth, the first geographical map of the earth finds a mention in Maharshi Vedavyasa's Mahabharata. So if we remember the Shruti tradition, the oral tradition, so this is part of that particular tradition where it was described. So where it was described? We find that in the Mahabharata. So it is described in Sanskrit verse as Sudarshanam Pravakshami Dvipam Tu Kuru Nandana Parimandalo Maharaj Dvip Asau Chakra Sansthita Yathahi Purushah Pashye Dwadarshe Mukhatmana Evam Sudarshan Dvipo Drishyate Chandra Mandale Dviranshe Piplah Tatra Dviranshe Cha Shasho Mahan. So basically, when we learn this in Sanskrit and translate it into English, we find the description of the earth. How? Let's understand. Hey Kurunandan, this island called Sudarshan is a spherical circle like a man sees his face in the mirror. So the island is visible in the lunar orbital. So the idea of lunar orbital was also there. In the two parts of the island, two leaves of people and great Sasha, basically the rabbit is called Sasha, are seen. So this description finds its first important place as a geographical map in the oral traditions, in the Shruti tradition that we see, and further in the Smriti traditions of Indian literature as well. So this is first kind of description of how the earth looks from this space, which has been mentioned in the Vedvyasa's Bhishma Parva of Mahabharata. So let's understand further. So if we observe these images carefully, if we observe these sketches carefully based on the verses of Bhishma Parva of Mahabharata, we find that it almost matches the description of the earth in terms of its land distribution and the ocean distribution as we can see in the modern times. So let's understand the roots of Indian geography in the ancient literature first. So what we see that the term Bhugol, that is basically geography, as we observe that geography as a term was coined by Eratosthenes during the Greek. So Bhugol, what we see here, is mentioned as Bhu, that is the earth, and Gol, that is the round. So concept of round earth was not new to India. Even before Greeks, we understood this concept that earth is not flat disk, rather it is, earth is round. So this round earth concept existed in our literature forms pre-Greek era as well. So what we see here is that Bhugol has been mentioned in the, as in the text that we observe, and it is found first time after the written traditions come in during 8th century Puranic text, that is Bhagavat Puran, as Bhugol. So what we observe is that during the Shruti, the oral traditions and Smriti traditions, we already had the concept of the round earth. So now coming to the scholars and their contributions, this is the list of scholars in various fields. So let's understand them. So 3000 before Christ, if we observe, cosmology was worked out by Acharya Kapil. Then we have Acharya Bharadwaj, 800 before Christ, in terms of the aviation technology. That was interesting. Then the description of mathematics, the medicine, physics, all the branches of knowledge largely we see in terms of the works of Bodhayana, Acharya Charak, Acharya Kanad, who also gave the atomic theory long before that came to the modern physics. So Acharya Sushrut we observe in terms of surgery, is also known as father of surgery, and Gautam Buddha that we observe through his philosophy. Panini's grammar is one of the important pivots of the literary traditions in ancient India. Nagarjuna's work in chemistry is very important. Aryabhatta's great work in astronomy and mathematics is considered one of the most important turning point in the history of mathematics, as the concept of zero was given by Aryabhatta. So this is the first one, Aryabhatta 1, whose time is in the 5th century after death. But Varahamihir also contributed further to astrology, Brahmagupta in mathematics and astrology, Bhaskara in mathematics and astronomy. Then we have Adi Shankaracharya in terms of philosophy, we understand the concept of Advaita. Then Sridharacharya also in mathematics, Brahmadev we see in 11th century mathematics and astronomy, and finally Bhaskaracharya in algebra. So what we see here is that two kinds of tradition that we observed. One was the ancient scholars in terms of the Shruti and Smriti traditions, and further we observe in terms of philosophy and science that we see here, these great scholars contributed to various forms of knowledge, right from cosmology, astronomy, aviation, philosophy, mathematics, and several more disciplines. So this is important contribution of the ancient Indian scholars in their respective field right from 3000 before Christ. So when we observe that at one hand Mesopotamia was there, so at the other end our Indian tradition was also there parallel to Mesopotamian civilization. So the above table clearly shows that ancient scholars in India made a significant contributions to the discipline of geography, especially in these fields as we discussed, philosophy, cosmology, mathematics, medicine and linguistics. And further, these information came to the contributions in geography in terms of regional geography, physical geography, climatology, practical geography, long before Copernicus and Galileo even thought about the concept of heliocentrism, and later on that how these directions are there, how to understand the distance between earth and sun. The scholars like Aryabhatta, Bhaskaracharya and Brahmagupta and Varahamihir had already contributed to these forms of knowledge in astronomy, especially in terms of planetary positions, planetary movements, planetary forces, latitude, longitude, local time, cardinal points. So here what we observe here is Panchasiddhantika. So they understood the dimensions of the earth in terms of yojana, which is converted to miles, and kilometers. So in this particular way, in the verses of Aryabhatta also, we find the description of the dimensions of the earth. So these are important calculations that we observe here in the Indian traditions of geographical thought. Another example can be cited from the concept of the Vedic times. So the times when we observe that knowledge was not in the written form, there were classification of the material world in five elements. We understand earth, fire, air, water, and ether. That is the five basic elements. So elemental forms of the knowledge, that is about Prithvi, Agni, Maya, Upper, and Aksha. So this is important description that we find in the Vedas as well. And then further, the five elements which we call Pancha Mahabhut has been identified with various human sense of perception. Not just independently five elements, but spatially related to human beings. So what we observe is not just physical forms of knowledge, but also the human forms of knowledge were existent during the Vedic times. So it is perceived that material world is composed of these Pancha Mahabhutas and hence comprised of minuscule particles matter as well. So long before the science, the physics, the modern physics understood the concept of atom, we already have description of Parmanu, which was also known to them. So that suggested that there was a possibility of even at an abstract level understanding of matter. So that is where the physics had a level in the ancient times in India as well. Now, the concept of the regions that we observe in modern geography has ancient roots in India as well, in the forms of the Dvipas description. So seven Dvip have been mentioned in Puranas. So what we observe again is the Smriti time period, not the Shruti time period. Puranas belong to the Smriti period, where the seven Dvipas have been identified and described. So the names are Jambudvip, Kronchadvip, Kushadvip, Palakshadvip, Pushkaradvip, Shakadvip, and Shalmalidvip. So the description of these Dvipas have been mentioned in the Puranas if you observe. So what we see here is Jambu is a place where you have rose apple tree. Then Palaksha is Indian fig tree. Shalmali is silk cotton area. Kusha is Kusha grass that we have. Kronch is basically the mountain region, the Kronch mountains. Then we have Saka, the teak tree. Then we have Pushkara, the lotus flower region. So all these places have been mentioned not just independently as physical regions, but also we observe in the description, they are the biogeographic regions if we observe, because they have descriptions of the biota in them. So that is interesting find in the ancient Indian geographical thought through this traditions of Shruti and Smriti, which were conserved and preserved. So the possible location as described of these seven Dvipas, if we observe placing them on the current world map. So it is largely that Bharatavarsha had this ancient roots of Jambudvip that we say. Then further, Kronchadvipa is largely the British Isles and the European Western segment that we observe. Palaskadvipa is basically all the Mediterranean if we can place. And further, Kushadvipa is the Arabian Peninsula and the further Asia Minor segment. And then Shalmalidvipa is largely the East African segment that we see. Sakadvipa is the Southeast Asian region and Pushkara is the northeastern part of the Asia. So what we observe, these seven Dvipas have been already described, and this leads to the clarity in terms of the world beyond knowledge of what existed just around Mediterranean in the Greeks and Romans. So that is one interesting find which have been described in the Puranas. Now, furthermore, when we see that directions are one of the important factors in today's geography as well, and it also had a pivotal role to play in terms of understanding of the places. So what we observe here is that Rig Veda, the oldest of the Veda, clearly states the idea of 10 directions, not just 4 directions like Eurus, Notus, Zephyrus, all those that were described in the Greek time, but even 10 directions. So what we see here is the plethora of knowledge in the ancient description of the directions. So Purva was eastern side, Paschim is west, Uttar is north, Dakshin is south, then we have Vayavya as northwest, Ishanya as northeast, Agreya as southeast, Naritra as southwest, Zenith as the Meru, and another position as Bhadvanala. So what we see here is these 10 directions, right from the positions of zenith to the nadir to all these further 8 directions have been described in Rig Veda. And furthermore, what we see here is that the concept of vacuum as antariksha, as heaven, was also already there. And the calculation that was there, what we observe is of 96 kilometers, as it was supposed to be 12 yojans, and one yojan is approximately 8 kilometers. So that is what we observe, that description of atmosphere is also mentioned in terms of its height. The description of India in the ancient. So what we find is the name Bharatavarsha during the Puranas time. So its extension has been mentioned in Himalaya to Kanyakumari, and it consists of regions like Saptasindhu, Himavat, Kailash Parvat, Vindhyans, Sahyadri. These are certain regions in which that Bharatavarsha can be divided. And rivers description is also there in forms of Ganga, Yamuna, Brahmaputra, Saraswati, Satudri, that is Satluj, Asikini, that is Chenab, Vitasta, that is Jhelum, Arjikeya, that is upper part of Indus, Susom, that is Savan, Sindhu, that is Indus, Kumbha, that is Kabul, Gomati, that is Gomala, and Kurmu, that is Kuram. So all these rivers have been mentioned, including Narmada and Tapi, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri, Tumbhadra as well in the ancient texts. And that is where we find the descriptive part of the geographical understanding of these particular physical elements. Now let's look at this particular description of the Puranic conception of Jambudvipa. As we observe that Jambudvipa was largely part of India and around. So what we see here is, in this particular description of the Jambudvipa, we observe that the world has been centered around Meru. So which is Mount Meru is largely the Pamir Mountains, as we can identify largely. And Ilavrita Varsha that we see here is just near this particular mountain. Right? So this is supposed to be the central part, the central axis along which this particular pivot, the entire other areas of the Jambudvipa are situated. So what we observe here is the Bharata here, then we have Himvata, then Kimpurusha, then Hemkota, Hari, Nisadha, then what we have is Meru, Nila, then Ramyaka, Sweta, Hiranmaya, so many other places have been described in the ancient texts. So what we observe is this particular description of Mount Meru and the other places around it. So detailed Puranic accounts, if we observe, has identified several mountain ranges as we see. So what we observe here is these are several mountain ranges in sequence one after the other. So if we take a cross profile of this particular area, what we observe is a trajectory like this one. How it is there? Because this is going to be the Mount Meru, and on both sides we have several other ranges which we have to cross to go to Meru, and further again we have the several other regions between which we have mountain passes, and people used to go along these mountain passes. So this has been particularly described in the Jambudvipa. Now let's talk about Indian geography condition during Middle Ages. So what happened? During Middle Ages, geography boundaries also further extended for Indians. As the people migrated into the Cambodian section that we observe, and also the connection with China and Greece were established. Further, they came contacts with Arabs, and then we had Muslim establishment of empire in India. So what we observe is that the continuation of geographic traditions here came from the Arab school of geographical thought in the Middle Ages, and the ancient knowledge that was there completely was lost in the next 500 years. So because of the translations, there were major loss, and also because of the changes in the education system, there were major losses. So what we observe in this period is the works of Al-Biruni, Ibn Battuta, and several more Arab scholars who wrote lots of book on India. So Tarikh in Hind, Kitab al-Hind, Al-Biruni's travel accounts, Aini Akbari, and several more, what we find has the geographical description of India in the Middle Ages. But remember, geography still was not part of any education system in terms of its formal education. So what happened? How it became part of the formal education system in India? It came through colonizers, through British India. So what we observe here is that many prominent societies were created in the British India. For example, Curzon Geographical Society at Aligarh in 1925, Madras Geographical Society in Madras 1926, Patna College Geographical Society in 1929, Calcutta Geographical Society in 1933, and Bombay Geographical Association in 1935. So these societies led to the promotion of the geography as an independent discipline right from 1920s in India, if we observe. So some great personalities in the field we observe at that particular time are N. Subramanyam from Chennai, R. M. Dubey from Allahabad, K. S. Ahmed from Lahore, Tahir Rizvi from Aligarh, and S. C. Chatterjee from Patna, who were the building blocks of geographical societies in British India. Furthermore, if we observe, to promote their knowledge of the territories, British further set up all the surveys in India. So, survey of India, like geological survey of India, zoological, botanical, linguistic, archaeological, and anthropological surveys in India. So, all these were established to gain more and more knowledge. So, what happens is geographical knowledge in terms of culture, people, places, anthropology, language, everything was further more in detail described and documented in British gazetteers through these surveys that British created. In 1875, Indian Meteorological Department under Government of India in British India was established, and that's why we see that India in terms of climatology is very advanced, still right coming from the British India as well. So Henry Francis Blanford, who was the first person to appointed at Meteorological Department as a reporter, he contributed a lot, and IMD headquarters later on shifted to Shimla from Calcutta in 1905, and later in Pune, and then now finally in 1944 in Delhi. So this is the journey of accumulation of geographical information about India during the British time period. So let's observe what happened after India got independent. What we say is geography in the modern India. So if we observe through the works of Rana in 2013 as he has published, so what we observe here is that he has divided that stages into four phases. So formative stage, informative stage, confirmative stage, and reformative stages that we see is pre-1950s, the 1950s, then 60s, and further after 1970s. So these are the major stages in Indian modern geography. While the geography discipline was evolving in other parts of the world as well, as we observed in the German, French, British, and American school of geographical thought, during the same time we had the inception of geography in India in 1924 in Aligarh Muslim University, and furthermore in other departments as well. So what we see is right now in 2020, when we see, we have still 4 years to go to complete the 100 years of geography as a discipline in India. So in 2024, we are going to cover 100 years of geography. We are going to celebrate 100 years of geography in 2024 in India as a field of advanced study, as a field of university system of education. So that is the journey in terms of right from British India to the geography in modern India. Now let's understand the major contributors in the modern part. After independent, people who contributed in various branches of geography. So there are several branches if you observe, like regional development and planning, urban geography, climatology, regional geography, administrative geography, agricultural geography, gender geography, geomorphology, geography of health, political, population, social, cultural, economic, resource, and transport geography. So what we observe here is several branches of geography, and great scholars, right from C.D. Deshpande to Sundaram to Pathak to R.P. Mishra to Professor Ram Lochan Singh of BHU, Professor Ramachandran, R.B. Singh, then we have P. Dayal, Speight, L.S. Bhatt, Gopal Krishnan, Mazad Hussain, Jasbir Singh, R.P. Singh, Savindra Singh, Anandita Datta Saraswati Raju period in modern geography in terms of the gender geography. Then we observe political geography in the works of R.D. Dixit, C.P. Singh. Then we observe population geography in the works of R.C. Chandana, Gopal Krishnan, G.S. Gosal. In terms of social geography, in the works of A. Ahmed and M. Ishtiaq, cultural geography, in the works of A.B. Mukherjee, Kashinath Singh, Rana P.V. Singh, economic geography by S.P. Chatterjee, resource geography by R.P. Mishra and Balashwar Thakur, transport geography by Hariharan Ramachandran. So all these major scholars, and apart from that, these great scholars and their students now are carrying forward the legacy of geography as a discipline in various university systems all around India and globe as well.
So now, when we have learnt about the contributions of various great scholars from India in terms of evolution of geographical thought, we understand that it was not just that knowledge was segregated and it developed in isolation only in the Western countries, but also we had great depths of knowledge at various time periods in India as well. So we'll be talking about more on geographical thought in lectures to come. So stay tuned, stay safe, and all the best wishes.